Good morning, everybody. Today we'll discuss about the plasticity part during the application of the mechanical load. So far we have discussed the elastic behavior and then two-dimensional stress state, three-dimensional stress state, and how we can find out the principal stresses in case of 2D and 3D. Now we'll shift to that plasticity part. So we'll start with it from the very basic things, that in this case the continuum plasticity, specifically the theory of plasticity, and when you apply the bulk of material, and how you can predict the yield surface when it is subjected to one dimensional load, or if it is two dimensional case, or maybe in general three dimensional cases. So first we'll start with the one-dimensional plasticity model, and what is the effect of other different strain hardening mechanism, or here we'll try to incorporate how the effect of strain hardening can be better explained just by simply looking into that stress strain diagram of a specific material. So first we'll cover the plastic deformation in tension and compression, what is the Bausinger effect, what is the yield criteria for the during the mechanical behavior of the material, and finally we'll try to discuss the different plasticity model, and followed by the different anisotropy model we generally used to predict the deformation of the material due to application of the mechanical load. So first we'll look into that. What do we mean by plasticity? Specifically, we use the plasticity theory. It's a mechanical behavior in the large scale strain hardening operation where the elastic component is very small, and mostly we can represent the deformation of the material throughout in the plastic zone only. So first objective should to represent the yield point when it is one-dimensional load, or maybe yield surface when there is a three-dimensional load or two-dimensional load. Then normality conditions or material stability condition, mathematically we will try to derive from the nature of the stress strain analysis of a specific material. Then what are different flow curves are used to model or to predict the plastic deformation of the material, and finally the strain hardening mechanism, how you can incorporate mathematically simply just looking into the stress strain behavior of a specific material when it is subjected to either one directional load, or when it is subjected to in general the three dimensional loading condition. So flow theory of plasticity, basically plastic deformation of the material, what is the sustainability of the deformation during the application of the load, that generally is discussed because based on the incremental strain mode, and that incremental strain actually depend on the stress state. So basically the flow theory of plasticity is generally explained in that way, that during the plastic deformation we can divide the total deformation into small zone or small part, and we try to apply the theory based on the small incremental strain part, and accordingly we can predict the stress state at that point. So this is the one type of approach we can follow in the plasticity theory. Another way, we can directly use the deformation theory that actually directly the indicate the total strain to total stress. But in this case, probably the path of the plastic deformation is more important, and this path generally follow in the not in very linear way. Specifically, it follows the nonlinear path. So we generally try to follow the first approach, and where the nonlinear path of the plastic deformation is decomposed into small zone or small part, and we'll try to update each and every step what is the state of the plastic strain, and accordingly we can predict the stress also at that point. So it is like that stress induces strain rate, specifically which is analogous to the pressure and velocity. So similar way we can equivalently we can say that it is really very similar to the stress and strain, like pressure and velocity. Basically, the pressure difference in, actually induces some velocity when you try to analyze the flow through a pipe. So similarly, here stress actually induces the strain. Based on this approach, we'll further discuss the plasticity theory applicable for one-dimensional case. In general, there are several important comments or points before starting of the theoretical analysis of plasticity. I like to mention all these points like that. The theory of plasticity actually is concerned with a number of different types of problems. So be aware of materials at strains where the Hooke's law is no longer applicable here, because we know that Hooke's law we can apply only for the elastic analysis, because the stress and strain within the elastic limit follow some linear relationship. But in this plasticity theory or plastic deformation of the material, that path is completely non-linear. Plasticity is concerned with predicting the safe limits for use of the material under combined stresses. That means the maximum load which can apply to a body without causing excessive yielding, fracture and flow. So this way we try to predict the what may be the maximum load or what may be the safe limits of the material. So plasticity actually deals with that safe limit and the maximum load. Third, plasticity is understanding the mechanism of the plastic deformation of the metals. So it deals with the plastic deformation of the metal. And fourthly, plastic deformation is not a reversible process and depends on the loading path. That is most important thing, is that plasticity actually depends on the loading path by which the final state is achieved. So it is really very difficult to predict at a one single step what is the final state of the plastic deformation by looking into the initial. So if we do not follow the path of the deformation. In the plastic, fifthly, the plastic deformation, there is no easily measured constant relating to the stress and strains with Young's modulus for elastic deformation. For example, in case of elasticity, we can easily measure the Young's modulus by simply looking into the slope. But when the stress strain path is specifically nonlinear, then it is not easily to determine all the constants involved in the plasticity theory. Finally, the phenomena of the strain hardening, plastic anisotropy, Bausinger effect cannot be treated easily in the theory of plasticity. But we will try to see how mathematically we can predict or we can use all this constant in the overall explanation of the plasticity theory. So looking into that several important points, plasticity theory, we just try to shift on the what are the loading path or specific to plastic deformation when it is subjected to uniaxial loading condition. First we will look into this figure. Here we see that this is actually true stress strain curve for a ductile material. We have already discussed the true stress strain curve and what is the difference of the true stress strain curve from the engineering stress strain curve during the mechanical loading of a material. So here if you see that this is a true stress strain curve for a ductile material, and Hooke's law is followed up to the yield stress sigma 0, and beyond sigma 0 the metal deforms plastically. This is a very typical deformation behavior of the material when we assume the behavior of the metal is elastoplastic in nature. So very first part up to sigma 0, that is the elastic part, and afterwards when it crosses the elastic limit, it just enters to the plastic deformation zone. And at point A, if we see that when we remove the load at point A, it will come back to the position at this position. So that position actually with some elastic recovery part. So this amount is the elastic recovery part in this case. That means epsilon 2 to epsilon 1, that difference is the elastic recovery. But from origin 2 up to epsilon 2, that amount actually represents the permanent deformation of the material. So this is the typical elastoplastic behavior of a material. Now if we look into that right hand side figure, it represents the same stress strain diagram, but except it shows that what happens during the unloading and reloading. So up to point A, there is a point A is the application of the load up to point A, then release of the load, basically unloading, and it is come following some arrow path and it come back to the origin by the stream axis cross. Again we reload the same sample, it follows the different path, but this unloading and reloading path differences may not be very high, so that gap is very small in this case. But this difference in the loading and unloading path is basically called stresses. So the curve is not exactly the linear and not exactly the parallel to the elastic portion of the curve. This is the typical behavior we observe in the material, that if that gap indicates some properties of the material, that is called damping properties of the material. If that gap remains very high, then that means indicates that the damping property of the material is very high. For example, gray cast iron having very good damping properties. So specifically when you try to produce that stress strain diagram for gray cast iron, that amount, gap amount will be very high. But in specific steel, probably that gap will be more less, almost equal to the reloading and unloading path. So in that case, the damping properties of the material are very less. So this is the indication of the from the stress strain curve, but this specific phenomenon is called the stresses. Now we look into the several other model of the plasticity model of the different material. If you look into that left hand side figure as well, if we see that with the application of the load at point O, and it is follow certain path and reach up to this point, and if we change the loading condition from tensile, first part is showing the from the tube to the application of the tensile loading, and if we change the loading condition, that means if we again put the compressive load and it is follow the path below the negative side and it is come back to some other point. So here the important point to note is there, the initially that yield stress in tension is sigma A, here it is indication, and yield stress in case of compression, that is sigma B. But it's not necessary that yield stress in tensile should be equal to the yield stress at the compression. There is a material is having the actual, there is a difference of the yield stress in tensile and yield stress at compressive load. So that difference in tension is greater, specifically the yield stress in tensile is greater than that of the yield stress in compression. So this specific phenomena is called the material is having Bossinger effect. So that is, Bossinger effect is very much significant when material is subjected to some kind of reverse loading condition. That means specific cyclic loading, whether it is tensile, compressing kind of loading. So in that sense, the Bossinger effect is very much significant to consider for the plasticity analysis of a specific material. If you look into the right hand side, so there are other models also exist. First one is the rigid ideal plastic material. If we see that with respect to the strain, the stress is always constant. So this kind of material behavior is called rigid but ideal plastic material. If you look into other two models also, third and fourth model as well, that third model indicates the ideal plastic material with elastic response. And here we see that there is an elastic part is there up to the sigma zero is the yield point here, and afterwards that yield stress is constant over the deformation. So this type of specific material model is called the ideal plastic material with the elastic component. Final one is that piecewise linear. So sometimes we represent the elastoplastic behavior of the material in terms of the two slopes. That is something it is called bilinear isotropic material. So there is a two linear path. One, that first linear path actually represents the elastic limit or elastic zone, and second linear path actually represents the plastic part. So that is the second path is that since it is not the constant with respect to the strain like previous two models, so there is a variation of the stress value, specifically there is the increment of the stress value over the strain in the plastic zone. So this type of behavior is called the strain hardening material. So that means strength level of the material is increased with the further straining. So with respect to the strain, the stress value increases. So this type of specific material model we frequently use, that is called bilinear isotropic hardening. Apart from the several models, plasticity models, now we come to that point, the two stress strain curves actually frequently called also the flow curve, and we have already discussed the two stress strain curve also most frequently or most significant for the plasticity analysis. So therefore we are focusing on the further analysis of the stress strains. That is, by default we should consider that is the two stress strain curve. But sometimes it is called the flow curve because it gives the stress required to sustain the plastic deformation of the material. So mathematical equation we often or most commonly used to describe the stress strain relationship is the power expression of the form, that sigma equal to k epsilon to the power n. That k is a constant and that is called the strength coefficient, and n is basically called the strain hardening coefficient. So this is a very useful or in most commonly used the stress strain relation, that is called the power law relation. We used it, but all here the stress and strain components are represented in terms of the true strain and true strain. Now for this specific equation, if we try to plot this specific equation in a logarithm scale, then we can find out that logarithm sigma equal to logarithm of k plus n logarithm of epsilon. So basically this relation represents the linear relations on the logarithm scale. Now n actually represents the slope at the logarithm scale. So let us see how that strain hardening coefficient can be defined. Copper and brass, the strain hardening coefficient is only 0.5 and can be given the large plastic strain before fracture as compared to the steel. That means for steel the strain hardening coefficient is 0.15 as compared to copper and brass as 0.5. What does physically the signify these things? That means with the same deformation, the n is more, means the slope in the stress strain diagram, specifically I am talking about in the plastic zone, slope is very high. So when there is a slope is very high with the same deformation, the stress level of the material actually increases very high when there is having high strain hardening coefficient. But in case of steel having low strain hardening coefficient, so in this case with the same amount of the deformation or same amount of the strain, the increment of the stress level is less as compared to the copper or brass. So other way, that large plastic strain can be given to the copper since it is having the strain hardening coefficient is very high, but low amount of the plastic strain or plastic deformation can be absorbed by the steel also. Now when the true stress is less than 1, the smaller value of n dominates over the larger value of n. So since n actually represents in terms of the slope on the logarithm scale, so dou logarithm sigma by dou logarithm n, this is the in the stress by strain on the logarithm scale, that ratio actually represents the slope, and we are representing here that n in terms of the at fixed strain rate and fixed temperature. Since the plastic deformation having the effect, or it depends on the strain rate or temperature. We will discuss the effect of the strain rate and temperature on the plastic deformation later on. But for the time being, if you see that the what are the typical values of n, that means strain hardening coefficient and the constant term for the different materials. The values of the different n and k indicates that for copper is having very high values of n, that is 0.54, but the quench and tempered steel is having low value of strain hardening coefficient, that is 0.1. But if you see that strength coefficient is very high in case of tempered steel, that is 1570, but it is low as well as annealed copper. So in this case, if you see that strain hardening coefficient n and k, the strength coefficient, there is a that follows some vice versa relation. Now we'll try to see that two stress strain curve, focusing on that, we'll try to represent the how we can define different slope, or maybe I can say that the different parameters which is analogous to the stress strain diagram or in the plastic deformation zone. First we define one typical stress strain diagram, and if we consider very small part of the diagram, that is corresponding to strain is d epsilon and stress is corresponding to d sigma. So here we can define the several slope. For example, the slope for the stress strain curve, absolute value of the stress strain curve actually represents the slope at this point. So it is like that. So that slope we can say simply d sigma by d epsilon. But since this is the material behavior is like elastoplastic in nature, so we can decompose the total amount of the strain is consist of the elastic part as well as plastic part. And elastic part, we separate out the elastic part is related to the elastic modulus, and plastic part we can say related to the plastic modulus. But how we can correlate between all these slopes? So E here is defined, the I think E is a slope for the stress elastic strain curve, so that specifically represents the d sigma by d epsilon E, that is the reference to the elastic component of the strain. H is defined that slope for the stress and the plastic strain curve. So individually if we define all these three different slope, then we can find out the correlation, like assuming the elastoplastic behavior of the material and by decomposing the elastic part and plastic part. And here if we see using all this definition of the slope, if we put it here, we can find out 1 by ET, 1 by E plus 1 by H. So finally we can find out H, that means slope for the stress and plastic strain curve. So I can say simply we can say that only for the slope for the plastic component, that is the E divided by E minus E slope, this should be E T. So that is the slope on the plastic component. So this is the simplified way we can find out the slope of the different, if we consider pure elastic, if the component consists of the pure plastic and when it is subjected to the elastoplastic. So ET in terms of stress and the total strain curve, that we can easily measure ET from the diagram itself, and E for the slope of the stress strain curve, that also we can measure, which is defined as the specifically the initial slope. So looking into that two part, we can roughly estimate what is the age in this case. So this is some mathematical treatment we can find out, or we can, when we are dealing the, or there is a need to estimate the different slope of the curve, then we can easily find out. So this calculation is specifically useful when you try to do some mathematical modeling using some finite element analysis. Now during the plastic deformation, normally after the yield point stress, there is a uniform deformation up to certain point, but when it is reaches to some optimum point in the typical stress strain diagram, so at that point there is a competition between the work hardening and for the reduction in the cross-sectional area. So the instability of the plastic deformation actually starts from that point. So that typical point is considered as a necking point. So that is corresponds to the point of the maximum load if we consider the load deflection curve of a typical material. So specifically the necking starts with the localization of the stress. So at that point or beyond that point, actually stress no longer remains in the single dimension. So triaxial state of stress actually exists, and that localization happen maybe from the point of the defects exist within the material itself. So it is necessary to analyze the plastic instability condition at that point, specifically at the necking point, beyond which there is a random reduction of the cross-sectional area. And finally, when it reach to a certain point where the fracture of the materials happens, so how we can establish this plastic instability condition at the necking point? So necking we consider at this point, there is a competition, because with the application of the load, there is a reduction of the cross-sectional area, but at the same time, there is a increment of the stress level. So that is called the increment of the stress level due to the work hardening or due to the strain hardening. So since that engineering stress strain diagram actually represents that point as the maximum point, but load deflection, with respect to the load deflection curve, that point represents the maximum point. It is like that. So this maximum point actually would try to predict the plastic instability condition. So mathematically we can say that since that is the optimum point, in the sense that D of applied load, so F is the applied load here, and so DF equal to 0, that is the typical condition for the plastic instability. Now F can be, load can be represented by stress and cross-sectional area sigma into A, and then D of sigma A equal to 0 is the typical conditions when the instability of the plastic deformation actually starts when it is subjected to uniaxial loading condition. Now if you do the further analysis or further expression of this plastic instability condition, you can find out that dou D of sigma into A can be decomposed into this two part, A of d sigma plus sigma of dA. Sorry. That is equal to 0. So from here we can find out d sigma by sigma equal to minus dA by A. And finally, but what is the values of dA by A here? That also we can find out the volume in compressibility torque. There is a, we assume there is a no change of the volume during the plastic deformation. That means delta of volume equal to 0, dV equal to 0 here. Now again V equal to, if we assume V equal to volume equal to cross section area into length, if we put it d of AL, it becomes A into DL or plus L into dA equal to 0. So from this point we can find out dA by A equal to minus dL by L. That actually represents d epsilon dl by l, that is d epsilon is the two strengths for the element. So we can say dA by A in terms of epsilon. So dA by A equal to minus d epsilon, we put it, we get this relation, and finally d sigma by d epsilon equal to sigma. So this is the plastic instability condition generally we used for the uniaxial loading condition. So uniform elongation will happen when d sigma by d epsilon is greater than sigma. We will try to explain graphically that the typical condition of the uniform deformation or non-uniform deformation. But with this plastic instability condition, if we try to use this condition for the power law, so power law means this is the typical representation of the, or maybe we can say the relation between the stress and strain for the most common materials. So for this material we will try to predict the what may be the instability condition here. So if sigma equal to k epsilon n, then we can find out that d sigma by d epsilon equal to k n epsilon epsilon to the power n minus 1. Actually this would be like this, k n epsilon to the power n minus 1. So this is comes from d epsilon by d sigma, and that is equal to sigma. But you use the, so that is equal to sigma. Sigma is given here, so that sigma comes from the power law relation, and from here we can find out epsilon equal to n. This is the typical instability condition when we consider the typical stress strain relationship by the power law. Now condition for making the graphical representation of the, so first graph represent the true stress strain. So this represent the typical true stress strain diagram, and d sigma by d epsilon, this line actually indicates the d sigma by epsilon. That means this line shows the slope d sigma by d epsilon. Now if we see the, when they are crossing point, that means crossing point actually represents the d sigma by d epsilon, that is the slope. This is one curve crossing with edge when it is equal to sigma, that is corresponding to this point. So this point actually indicates the necking. Graphically this point indicates the necking, but d sigma by sigma is greater than sigma before necking. So this zone is represents the before necking, and this zone represents the after necking zone. So before necking zone, it is obvious that at any point, if you consider at any point, this is the value of the sigma and this is the value of the corresponding slope d sigma by d epsilon. So basically before necking, the d sigma by d epsilon is always greater than that of sigma, but after necking just reverse. So d sigma by d epsilon will be less than sigma after necking. So this is the condition of the necking is met when the two stress strength equal to the slope of the two stress strain curve. So this is the graphical representation of the plastic instability condition. Now we can do the further analysis of this plastic instability condition for a different kind of loading condition. For example, is that if for the power law, that means P epsilon to the power n, this is the power law. So what may be the maximum load in this case? So for the power law, we derive the plastic instability condition actually epsilon equal to n. Now if we put it here, it becomes k, since epsilon equal to n, so n to the power n is represents the maximum load from where the actually necking starts. So before necking, this is the amount of the stress the material can sustain, that when we are following the plastic instability condition and when we are using the power law relations between the stress and strain. So other parameters can also be extracted like that. So what may be the engineering stress for the optimum condition, that means at the when about to start the necking. So engineering strain can also represent the two strain by 1 minus epsilon to the power e, that we have already derived. So here if we put the condition epsilon equal to n, so if we put it, we are getting the sigma t epsilon to the power minus n. So engineering strain in terms of two stress and in terms of strain hardening coefficient we can find out. Similarly, we can find out the also in directly that in other way, the k, what may be the engineering stress here, so first sigma t equal to, this is the two stress, k epsilon to the power n, but epsilon equal to n here, so k n to the power n exponential minus n. This is the further calculation for that. Now k n to the power n e to the power minus n, we can find out this is the value. So here the engineering stress in terms of the strain hardening coefficient n and the strength coefficient, that can be obtained when we are following the plastic instability condition for a specific material. So basically at the necking point, what may be the engineering stress. Now we can also find out that what the work per unit volume. So we know that over the stress strain diagram, if we consider one element d epsilon, then generally we represent y dx, the area of the curve. But here physical representation on the stress strain curve, that is equal to the amount of work done per unit volume. So here, which is equivalent to y axis, that means sigma, and x axis corresponding to epsilon. So that integration form, integrated form, actually represents the amount of work done per unit volume with reference to the specific stress strain diagram. Now if we put sigma equal to k epsilon to the power n following the power law d epsilon, we can find out this is the expression of work done. So several manipulation or several expression can also be derived by using the plastic instability condition, and when the relation between the stress and strain is actually known to us, then we can use this condition, we can derive several expression from that. Now apart from the simply power law, depending upon the type of material, that actually follow different type of expression or different type of relations between the stress and strain. That is, for example, some material follow sigma equal to y, that means constant. This is a typical stress strain diagram. Some material follow sigma equal to this y plus ae, so basically it's a straight line. linear relation, and some material follow this complex relation between stress and strain, where epsilon 0 actually indicates the initial amount of the strain, and some material follow this thing. So depending upon the type of material, the stress and strain relation can follow or can be represented by the different mathematical formulation. Now we look into one typical formulation. Let us see the express the uniform elongation in terms of constants of the following equation. So let us stress and strain actually follow this relation. So here this is the typical relation between stress and strain, and we try to find out the plastic instability condition. So this condition represents actually plastic instability condition, d sigma by d epsilon equal to sigma. But for this specific stress strain relation, we can find out that from here d sigma by d epsilon equal to a. So here d equal to a, that equal to sigma. Sigma is again corresponding y plus a into epsilon. So this is d sigma by d epsilon, and this is actually sigma. So from here we can find out epsilon equal to 1 minus y by a, and further calculation you can do, we can find out the amount of one term per unit volume. Similarly, we can find out the engineering strain like this. So engineering strain can be represented in terms of the constant, all are the constant of y a in that way. So these are the typical applications. So we can apply the plastic instability condition for the different type of material behavior when the mathematical relation between stress and strain is known to us for different type of materials. But it is mentioned to that point that simple tensile testing, we generally, when we conduct, we keep temperature as a constant, and we use the universal tensile testing machine, keeping the crosshead speed as a constant, probably in the very small speed we generally follow to conduct any tensile test of a specimen. But definitely the velocity, at what velocity the crosshead is moving, that is also an important parameter that actually influences the nature of the stress strain diagram. So if it is very low, if it is very slow, then probably it may not have any effect on that. But if we change the crosshead velocity, then there may be significant change in the stress strain diagram. So that means that crosshead velocity, which is very specifically equal to, in the mathematical term, that is called strain rate. So in other way, we can say that strain rate is also having influence on the stress strain behavior of a specific material. And at the similar way, if we change the temperature, if we change the temperature apart from the room temperature, then also stress strain behavior also changes for specific material. Specifically, at low temperature, the material hardens or material becomes, so that means strength level of the material actually increases due to the work hardening or strain hardening mechanism. But at the high temperature, maybe other mechanism, probably the strain rate is more effective in this case. So definitely although we are showing typical stress strain diagram, but this typical stress strain diagram, although it was evaluated over a constant temperature and constant strain rate, so practically this mechanical behavior of the stress strain of a specific sample or specific material is specifically influenced by the temperature and strain rate. So we should not neglect the effect of the other two parameters, for example strain rate and temperature. So in the variables of the plastic deformation, and now becomes four. One is the stress, another is the strain, strain rate, and temperature. So let us see how all these parameters actually affect the typical stress strain diagram of a specific material. Now we know that power law equation is mostly used when there is the effect of the strain hardening. Even the equation form of the equation indicates that we have the strain hardening coefficient N and the strain coefficient K. But deviation from this behavior are often observed. For example, austenitic stainless steels at low temperature, at low strain, specifically 10 to the power minus 3 and high strain, the typical behavior of the stress strain actually changes if there is change of the strain. Now, other forms of the power law equation can also be considered in the literature. So, we have discussed that we can predict the stress strain behavior at the different formula, but this is another form of the formula. Deviation from the power law, we can typically observe to represent the stress strain behavior of a specific material, that is sigma equal to sigma well plus k epsilon to the power n. So next point is that ideal plastic material. So ideal plastic material, the strain stress value remains the same irrespective of the or with the further straining, with the further deformation. That means there is no strain hardening effect in this case. So it starts yielding on the neck right to the onset, right to the begin to the neck, right to the onset of the yielding. So just start of the yielding, that its stress level becomes constant over the strain. But if you look into the physically, that low temperature, specifically the below recrystallization temperature, the strain hardening is very much significant parameter to obtain the good ductility. But during the tensile deformation, instability in the form of necking actually localizes the deformation in a small region. Now experiences a tensile state of stress on the onset of the necking of a specific sample. So these are the typical points or maybe notes for the plastic deformation, so that we can use this knowledge of the different plastic deformation, which is physically justifiable, to apply for the specific material. Now I come to that point, the separately analyzing the effect of the strain rate similar to the power law, where there is the effect of the strain hardening. At high temperature, specifically above recrystallization temperature, when strain rate is the important parameter, in that case, the instead of the strain, a power law equation can also be written in terms of the strain rate. So here we represent the power law relation such a way that sigma equal to C epsilon dot to the power m, keeping other two parameters fixed. So for a fixed strain and fixed temperature. So similar kind of expression, but here C is a constant similarly, but here m is the index of the strain rate sensitivity. So physically, when m equal to 0, the stress is independent of the strain rate. That means stress strain curve would be the same for all the strain rate. But practically m equal to 0.2 for the common material, but when m equal to very high, say 0.4 to 0.9, so almost near about 1, the material may exhibit the super plastic behavior. So we'll maybe this is not in our scope of to explain the super plastic behavior. But next is that m equal to 1, in that case material behaves like a viscous liquid. So this is the physical justification of different values of m. If we use it physically, we represent all these phenomena. But in general, we need to investigate the effect of the strain rate by using the similar kind of law, power law relations, simply by changing the coefficient here as compared to the strain hardening coefficient n. So, but the effect of the strain rate is compared by performing the state test to a constant strain. That means effect can be strain rate effect can also be considered if we conduct the test keeping the other two parameters constant, for example strain and temperature. So this is the typical expression for the standard sensitivity effect, that is relation between stress and strain rate. But how can correlate with respect to the other parameters here? Here M is the standard sensitivity index, so similarly we can represent the logarithm scale. So in the logarithm scale, M actually represents the slope. So that slope actually with respect to the logarithm of stress and logarithm of the strain rate. So if we conduct the experiment at the two different strain rate, for example, two different cross set velocity using the simple universal tensor testing machine, in that case we can measure the two different stress and two different strain rate, and we can correlate by this relation. So sigma 2 by sigma 1 equal to epsilon 2 dot by epsilon 1 dot is the effect. From here we can find out that M equal to, this is the expression. So that upper side and lower side, if we find out all these values from the typical experiments, then we can find out the standard sensitivity index for this specific case. So definitely in this case we are neglecting the effect of the strain hardening, and we are keeping as the temperature as a constant. So there is no temperature effect also here. Now this is the typical description. The graph actually represents that conducting the stress strain diagram typically at two different cross head speed V2 and V1. For example, V2 is greater than V1 here. So when we conduct the experiment at the high strain rate, or maybe at the high cross head velocity, then we can expect that this type of graph between the stress and strain. But when it is low, the strain level actually low in case of low cross head speed. So it is obvious that if there is a change of the cross head velocity in the universal tensor testing machine, so we can get the different stress strain diagram. Now looking into that data, how we can find out all this phenomena, or how we can correlate, or how we can find out the standard sensitivity index. There is other way also. For example, strain rate can be represented by d epsilon by dt, is a in differential form. So again, d epsilon is the two strain, that is dl by l by dt. So dl by dt by 1 by l. So we can say dl by dt, so length derivative, that represents the velocity, so v by l. So in this case, if we consider the total length of the sample, or total length of the cross head movement keeping as a fixed, that means L2 equal to L1, then we can simply that ratio of this strain rate, which is equivalent to V2 by V1. So V2 by V1 we can easily measure from the universal testing machines. If we put it, we can find out that sigma 2 by sigma 1, simply we can correlate in terms of the load, applied load, P2 by P1, and epsilon 2 by, and that means strain rate ratio can be, we can easily put the ratio of the velocity. So from here, we can compare, or we can evaluate the values of the strain rate sensitivity through experiments. Now further analysis of the strain rate sensitivity indicates that in some materials the necking is prevented by strain rate hardening. So when strain rate hardening mechanism, we will try to explain, but here the explanation comes from the very mathematical basis. We stick with the equation, this sigma equal to C epsilon dot to the power m. From that equation we can further modify this thing, sigma equal to C epsilon dot to the power m, which is equal to load by cross sectional area. Then this is direct relation, sigma equal to load by cross sectional area, and from here we can find out the strain rate equal to, simply rearranging this equation, we can find out the strain rate here in terms of load constant and cross sectional area. But strain rate again cannot be represented by d epsilon by dt, so it is like that, 1 by dt dl by l. So basically dl by sorry, dl dl by l can also be equal to the dA by A. So that actually comes from the keeping in mind that there is no change of the volume. So from that, so here it is. So no change of the volume. So basically dV equal to zero. So from here we can find out that dL by L equal to minus dA by A. So we further convert this expression, and finally we can find out dA by dt in terms of load and cross-sectional area. Now by looking into this expression, if we find out that m less than 1, that means the smaller cross-sectional area, the more rapidly the area is reduced. But when m equal to 1, the material behaves like a Newtonian viscous fluid, and of course dA by dt, so change of the cross-sectional area with respect to the time, so that is independent of the cross-section area. So this is the physical justification of m when you try to analyze that how there is a reduction of the cross-section area with respect to time here. This is the typical graphical representation of this phenomena. So dA by dt, we are representing this thing. What are the rate of the reduction of the cross-section area? The y-axis represents that, and x-axis represents the simply cross-section area. Now assuming that P by C, 1 by M, P by C as a constant term, we find out that for different values of the M, we can draw different graph. So for example, this one M equal to 1 by 4, in this case M equal to half, in this case M equal to 3 by 4th, and gradually when M equal to become, it becomes a horizontal line. So what does it mean? So increasing of M is basically towards this direction. So if M is tends to 1, then it becomes the Newtonian viscous fluid. But if M tends to lower value, then we can see that there is this reduction of the cross-sectional area is very high, okay, when M is very low value. And quickly there is a reduction of the cross-sectional area at the low value of the M as compared to the high value of the M. But if we accumulate the different various materials, if we consider the with respect to the percentage of elongation, which is sometimes called measure of the ductility also, the percentage of elongation that we see, and the typical M value is basically related by this diagram. So M is very high, so a percentage of elongation also very high. So M is very low, the percentage of elongation also low. So these are the physical representation of the change of cross-sectional area when there is a standard sensitivity is there. Now physically, what do we mean by N and M? Because we have used two constants N and M to explain the different plastic behavior of the material. So basically N actually represents the work hardening effect, and that effect is more significant up to the uniform strength, that means before start of the necking point. Up to that point, N is very much significant to analyze in this case. But M is a standard sensitivity index that is more significant to analyze visibly primarily the post-uniform zone, that means or necking region. So we can say in simply in general that N can be important parameter before start of the necking, and M can be important parameter after start of the necking. Because M, the plastic deformation, or maybe when you try to predict the flow stress, that is more effectively represented when there is an effect of the velocity, that means equivalent to the strain rate. So, but there may be the combined effect of the between stress and strain rate. So, if we consider the combined effect of the strain and strain rate, then we can represent the again modify the order like this. So, K epsilon to the power m n and strain rate to the power m. So, this is the typical expression of the stress when we are considering both the effect of the strain hardening and strain rate. So there is a, I am trying to explain the combined effect of the NM by looking into this phenomena that if we see that different expression for that, and let us look into them, they are significant of that. So first, strain is a straightway epsilon equal to minus ln A by A0. So this is a straightforward calculation I am trying to represent, and epsilon dot actually represents the strain rate, which is, and L is the length, and length and cross-sectional area is divided like that, related like that. So cross-section area and length is volume, and change of the volume equal to zero. So from here we can find the relation between the length and the cross-section area here. Now this is the further relation, the what is d by dt, d epsilon by dt. So basically this is strain rate, d epsilon by dt, this is basically strain rate. So here we can find out simple law of the using the simple derivative, and we can find out this is the relation. A significant point is there. Similarly, you can do the second derivative, epsilon double dot with respect to time, we will getting this expression, and but constant velocity test. So basically we generate typical test of the sample, we keeping velocity as a constant. So in that case we can neglect the acceleration, so that means L double dot will be zero. By considering this, we can find out expression of the epsilon double dot equal to this way. Now if we see in general, the stress is a function of strain and strain rate, because we are considering the combined effect of the both strain rate sensitivity index as well as the strain hardening coefficient. So then in that sense, when this is the stress, so derivative, so sigma dot here with respect to time, so we can d sigma here, we can find out the derivative here in terms of partial derivative form, and we can use this using the previous relation, we can find out all this expression. But when you try to predict the plastic instability condition, there is a change of the load equal to zero, or dp by dt equal to zero in this case, then we can find out the p dot equal to d by dt sigma. So accordingly we can find out this is the condition, and we put it here, and then we can try to find out sigma dot by sigma equal to in terms of other parameters. Then we find out that epsilon dot equal to this ln sigma by d epsilon. Now further is equal to 1, and here if you see that n equal to slope on the logarithm scale between the stress and strain, and m is the slope on the logarithm scale between the stress and strain rate, simply putting this value we can reach this condition, sigma equal to n by n plus 1. So this is also plastic instability condition when we are considering the combined effect of the both strain and strain rate. So this is the, if m equal to 0, then E equal to epsilon. So this is this condition actually considered a criteria. So this criteria is often used, and of course epsilon equal to n, and this criteria actually comes from when we are assuming the relation between stress and strain by the power law. And if you see the typical effect of the temperature and strain rate on the stress strain curve, actually the increasing the temperature decreases the decreases the flow stress value, because it actually initiates the slip process, and the slip process is actually thermally activated process. Similarly, increasing the strain rate is having the similar effect of the decreasing the temperature, or vice versa. So decreasing the strain rate and increasing the temperature also having similar effect. So we'll try to investigate, or maybe simply looking into what are the different type of materials and how it behaves with respect to the temperature and strain rate. So first we look into this figure for BCC polycrystalline material. Typically the stress strain curve is like that. So it's a stress and strain rate effect, one specific specific strain rate, and if we increasing the strain rate, then second curve actually represents the relation between the stress and strain. So if you see that if there is an increment of the strain rate, keeping as a temperature as a constant, for BCC polycrystalline material there is an increment of the stress level, and that increment actually follow almost uniform throughout the deformation stage. Similarly, for the same material, if we consider that effect of the temperature for a specific strain rate, then we see that increasing the temperature actually decreases the strength level, but throughout the strain there is a that gap between two different temperature, the state level is almost constant. So in this case, basically with respect to temperature, delta sigma, so difference between the strength level throughout the deformation process is almost similar, and that happens in case of BCC polycrystalline materials. But if you look into for the FCC polycrystalline material, you see that having similar effect. So increasing the strain rate, the stress level actually increases, but decreasing the temperature, the increasing the stress level, or vice versa, increasing the temperature, there is a decrement of the stress value in case of FCC polycrystalline material. But in this case, the increment of the stress throughout the strain value, it's not constant. So there is a continuous increment of this thing. So this is the basic difference, the effect of the temperature and strain rate in case of BCC and in case of FCC materials. This is the typical representation. If you see that for BCC material, there is a proof stress, or we can say it's a flow stress value, or sometimes we can use the yield stress value with increasing temperature. So initially at low temperature, yield strength value is very high, but with the increment of the temperature, the initially there is a high rate of decrement of the yield value over a temperature difference. Afterwards, it decreases to very low value even at very high temperature. But if you look into the for BCC materials, effect of the strain rate will be seen that there is a considerable improvement of the yield stress value or proof stress value in case of BCC material. And this is see that 293 Kelvin only, so room temperature, and this is the low temperature, below room temperature 143 and 77 Kelvin. So all the cases, the increment of the strain rate actually with the increment of the strain rate, that actually yield stress level in general decreases, in general increases irrespective of for a fixed temperature value. But this effect is more when the temperature is high as compared to the low temperature, 77 or 143 Kelvin in this case. Now, sometimes it was found that pre-existence of some kind of localization of the stress, or pre-existence of the defects on a specific sample, that actually initiate the necking process. So sometimes initially we make the samples at the not a uniform cross section, maybe intentionally we keep it as a low cross section or specific point, so that we can ensure at that point the necking should start, and that actually facilitated the different experimentation of the plastic behavior of a specific sample. But how mathematically how we can predict this necking phenomena, or how we can represent what is the effect of this necking over the stress strain diagram. Mathematically, we can see the introduction of the small variation in the cross section area in a small region along the specimen length, and observe whether this reaction actually further shrinks or grows with application of the load. In the sense that we say DL D A dot equal to 0, or we can say D A dot by D A equal to 0. So here we are in terms of A instead of L, that means we are representing in terms of area of cross section instead of L. So physically we try to look into that, what is the reaction of the area, what is the change of that at that point. So if we investigate it, then we can mathematically introduce the instability condition at that point. Suppose load is represented by this P equal to sigma into A, so that that sigma A, assume there is a variation of the sigma plus delta sigma, and there is a variation of the cross section area delta plus A. So from here we can derive that actually d sigma by sigma equal to minus dA by A. And finally, we can find out that this is equal to d sigma. That condition is we have already derived, and that we consider as a plastic instability condition. So, to ensure knocking at a specific position, the cross section is sometimes reduced. So, it is necessary to analyze if there is a change of the cross section area, actually, how it influences to the stress strain behavior. For example, we consider as a one bar having two different cross section area A, and in between there is a cross section area B. So cross section area B is less than A. Now the difference of the between the strains of the different regions depends on the value of the N, assuming that means strain hardening effect here we consider. If n is high, the difference will be less than if n is low. So let us investigate mathematically how we can do that. Assume that there is the application of the load F in the bar, so that F will be transmitted throughout the any section. So at section A, this is the load, and at section B, this is the load. So that is the stress into at that time, at that point, what is the cross section area. And this is a stress and the cross section area at that point. Now A B cannot be expressed in terms of, suppose what is the, this is the relation that between the initial cross section area and some intermediate point, what is the cross sectional area when there is a continuous deformation of the process. So that relation we have already derived, and it is connected with the two strain here. So similar expression we use A0. So A0 actually represents the initial cross section area before the application of the load, and AA actually represents the current cross section area. So similarly we can do for the cross section area B also. Then we can use the relation, stress relation, using the power law relation between stress and strain, sigma equal to K epsilon to the power M. If we put it, we find out this expression. So here if we see that in terms of epsilon A, in terms of epsilon B, so we can represent these things, and where F is the ratio of the initial cross section area, AB0 by AA0. So it is obvious that B0, section B we consider as a less cross section as compared to A. So F is basically less than 1. And this we can do the sensitivity analysis, in the sense if the ratio F is less than 1, if even F is 99%, that means if we consider F 0.9999, So the stress deformation behavior will be completely different from at section A and B. That we can do the further analysis by looking into this expression. But here point is that we need to evaluate epsilon A or epsilon B, that is through numerical procedure. So simply trial and error method we need to follow to find out the epsilon A here. The similar kind of treatment can also be done specifically at high temperature when there is the effect of the standard is more significant. So in that case we need to consider sigma equal to C epsilon dot to the power m, and we can do the similar treatment. So yes, similar way we can instead of sigma A here, so we can use the epsilon A dot to the power m. So then in terms of m we can find out the similar kind of expression. So this is all about the one dimensional stress strength and what are the effect of the strain hardening coefficient, at the same time what are the effects of the strain rate sensitivity index, and what are the combined effect if metal behavior is in such a way that both the strain hardening and strain rates both are significant for the mechanical behavior of the material. So we can do all this analysis from this expression what we have I have discussed just almost last 1 hour. So next class I'll try to analyze the basic plasticity theory, the one with yield criteria, how we can found out, and that will be very specific to the two-dimensional or three-dimensional stress strain. So thank you very much for your kind attention.